30 seconds for your questions.
Hi, Lisa Marie Compaletta. This question's for Mr. Scott. You said in the code of debate that Cape Camp landowners had a right to sell their property, yet it was the rezoning of the multifamily that allowed that development to occur. Did they have the right to rezone in your mind, and does the owner of a 10-acre lot in my neighborhood have a right to build a multifamily apartment too?
We have to slow down a little somewhere than that.
Okay, sure.
Okay, you're saying they have the right to...
Slow, would you like me to read it slower?
Yeah, read it slower.
I'll read it real slow. You said in the code of debate that Cape Camp landowners, I don't know which part you didn't get, had a right to sell their property, yet it was the rezoning to multifamily that allowed that development to occur. Did they have the right to rezone in your mind, and does the owner of a 10-acre lot in my neighborhood have the right to build multifamily apartments too?
Yes, they had the right to rezone, and I don't know the conditions of your lot.
And was there an answer I was looking for?
I spoke for over a year against the apartment complexes on Cape Camp. It wasn't the best or the highest use of the property, and I don't think there are many people in this room who would think otherwise. 74% of voters voted that they would like that to be parkland. What we got was yet again another student housing complex in a single-family neighborhood. They are now going through all of the issues that all the other neighborhoods have gone through that have been saddled with these thousand-bedroom student housing complexes. I'm on the neighborhood commission, and I'm attempting to work with that neighborhood right now to decide whether they're going to get parking stickers or what they're going to do to keep the apartment shenanigans from overflowing into their neighborhoods.
Another question from the audience. Brian, this is a question for Mr. Scott. Do you really believe that 1,000-bedroom rent-by-the-bedroom apartment complexes are neighborhood compatible, being placed right across the street from quiet, well-established, single-family neighborhoods?
In that particular situation, yes, it works.
Is there...
I don't know what particular situation he's talking about, so I'll just refer to them in general. They're incompatible, and anyone who lives next to one or knows someone who lives next to one knows that they're incompatible. It doesn't matter if you get the parking stickers or what you do, they're still very noisy. They finally put one in next to me after years of me going and speaking against these developments back, I believe it was last August when they put Capstone Cottages in. And my neighbors are, they have small children. We have about seven or eight children under the age of probably 8 years old on my street. Their kids can't sleep at night. They're calling the police constantly. They feel like they can't hang out in their backyard because of the profanity and just the loud parties going out at the pool. And it really deteriorates your quality of life and for homeowners. That's our biggest investment that we ever make. You know, a lot of us are hoping that we get to retire the equity of our home, and we won't be able to if our lives and our homes have been deteriorated to the point they're not worth anything.
Are there other questions from the audience?
David Wendell, this is for Mr. Scott.
Please speak into the microphone, sir.
David Wendell, this is for Mr. Scott. Your recently accepted $1,000 contribution from a principal in the company High Point Trace, Mrs. Karen Williams, is seeking $19 million TID incentive for the city that is scheduled for a vote in 2 weeks. What do you say to citizens who feel that this is inappropriate, and do you intend to keep the contribution?
Well, I don't think it's inappropriate, actually. As a matter of fact, I wasn't on the committee to decide the facts or any of the negotiations that went on for that development. I let that to three other council members to participate in that. So as far as will I keep it, I have kept it. I haven't spent it. It's still there, along with all the other contributions that I have.
Derek?
I wonder how the citizens can be assured that Mr. Scott's going to be able to make an unbiased decision or an impartial decision when he's accepted a $1,000 donation from someone and the vote is in 2 weeks. Our city charter, and I was on the charter review committee, so, or commission, so I'm very familiar with the ethics portion of it. And as a city council member, you're supposed to steer away from anything that could even give the appearance of impropriety. And I think that anyone that sees a $1,000 donation and then knows that you're going to be voting for that person, they have a $19 million pit on the line, is going to seriously wonder whether that vote of yours is purchased or not. Just my opinion.
Is there another audience question?